Good morning. And welcome to Kewanee First United Methodist Church. We're glad that you're with us this morning. We welcome those who are here in person, as well as those who are watching us on Comcast or Facebook. And please let us know if you're out there watching. We appreciate hearing from you. As we get started this morning, we have some announcements. And the first is that today is the Super Bowl sub fundraiser that our youth group is doing. And so they will be downstairs in Fellowship Hall making sandwiches to order. And they're $8 for your choice of turkey or ham with your choice of three different types of cheese. And then they also have, I know, lettuce and tomato and mustard and mayonnaise that can go on these sandwiches as well. So be sure to stop down there and order from our youth and help support our youth this morning. Then I want to share the schedule for this week. The M&Ms will be meeting tomorrow afternoon at 2 o'clock. Then there's an Administrative Council Ad Board meeting at 6 o'clock tomorrow evening. The Ladies Bible Study will resume on Tuesday morning at 9:30. And then the Guild Circle will be meeting on Wednesday evening at 7 p.m. The choir is back, and the choir will be singing this morning, but we are resuming our choir practices also this week at 7 o'clock on Thursday in Price Lounge. And then this coming Saturday, the 18th, there is a Walk to Emmaus gathering that our church is hosting at 7 p.m. down in the Fellowship Hall. And anyone is welcome to come to these, but especially if you've been on a Walk to Emmaus, we want to invite you to come and be a part of this gathering with others from around our area. And then there is an envelope in your bulletins this morning for United Methodist Committee on Relief. Umpqua Sunday is actually not until March, but with the earthquake that just happened over in Turkey and Syria, we want to help them. Umpqua was on the scene right away helping with relief, and we want to help them out by giving our gifts. And so we're inviting you to give a gift today, and you can see on the back of the bulletin to mark your envelope for relief, and then there's a number that goes with that so that it goes to the right place. But if you want to just give today, that would be great, and that would be helpful, and we'll get it out to UMCOR as soon as we possibly can. I got one more announcement here. Next Sunday afternoon at 2 o'clock, there is a community Black History extravaganza that is happening at the First Congregational Church, and they are going to have the Wethersfield High School Choir, music from other local churches, congregational singing, and presentations on African American history. And so if you're interested in that, that's 2 o'clock next Sunday, February 19th, at the First Congregational Church. I invite you to go and be a part of that extravaganza. Okay, I think those are all the announcements that I need. Oh, one more. I just remembered. Donna sent me an email yesterday. People have been asking about the offering envelopes. And we shared back in January that there was a delay in getting the envelopes printed because of a paper shortage and supply chain issues and shortage of workers. And she got an update on that they're still behind on getting orders filled. So they're expecting, hopefully, by the end of February or early March to have the envelopes to us. In the meantime, keep giving. We do appreciate your giving. And if you want to use the envelopes in the pews, feel free to do so. All right, I think that's all. So let's join together in our call to worship. I would invite you to stand with me. And let's join responsively. What does our God require of us? God calls us to a life of love in all our relationships.
God also calls us to a life of faithfulness and obedience.
Let us worship the God who calls us and trusts us to follow faithfully.
We come to worship our God and show our love for Him and for the people in our lives.
Please join in singing the opening hymn 384, Love Divine, All Love Excelling.
Love Divine, All Love Excelling. Good morning.
Good morning.
Let us go to the Lord in prayer, shall we? Oh Lord, your love has brought us together, and it is your love that sustains us through each day. We pray that you would keep us faithful, Lord. Even as we watch for signs of your kingdom, strengthen us to work with you to bring about, here and now, your reign on earth. Give us the courage to witness to your presence in the world today, tomorrow, and way into the future.
Yes.
We pray in the name of the one who comes, Christ our Savior. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Well, at this time, I'd like to invite our children to come forward as we share in our children's time together this morning. They're on their way. Good morning. How are you guys this morning? Good, good. All right. So today is a special day. Every Sunday is special. But some people think that this should be a holiday. Do you know what today is? The Super Bowl. Okay. And did you know that today is Abraham Lincoln's actual birthday? And it used to be a holiday, but then they moved out all the President's Day. But it's Super Bowl Sunday. So do you have a favorite team playing in the Super Bowl? No, not this year. Do you, Jace? Who's your team? Kansas City. Okay. Yeah, go Patrick Mahomes. All right. But there is a special day coming up this week on Tuesday, and it's Valentine's Day. How do we celebrate Valentine's Day? What do we do for that day? Do you still give Valentine's to your classmates at school? Do they still do that? They did when I was young, okay? And do you share a Valentine with your family, with mom and dad maybe, and maybe do something special to show the people you love how much you love them, okay? And I want to show you the most beautiful Valentine that I ever received. It's right back here. Okay. Now, you may say, that's not a Valentine. It doesn't really even have hearts on it. But do you know why the cross is the most valuable Valentine I ever got? Because that's where Jesus showed his love for me and for you. When Jesus went to the cross and died on the cross, he was showing us God's greatest gift of love that's ever been given. And the Bible says, greater love has no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. And that's what Jesus did for us, to show us his love for us. And that's why this is the most beautiful Valentine that any of us can ever receive, because Jesus is the only one who ever died for me and for you. So I have some paper Valentines here that I'm going to give you that say Jesus loves me, and they're like a coloring page that you can take, and you can color it if you have some crayons or markers and give it to somebody if you'd like to do that. But I think Jesus wants more than just a paper Valentine from us. He wants us to give him our heart and our life, because he gave his love for us. He wants us to give our love back to him. So let's say a prayer and ask him to help us do that. Let's pray. Loving God, we thank you for the great love that you have shown us in your son Jesus, who came and died on the cross for our sins and for our salvation. Help us to return our love to you and to keep that great commandment that says to love the Lord our God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and then to share that love with our neighbors as well. We give you the praise and the glory in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. All right, I want you guys to take a couple of those with you, and then I have something else here that I want to share with you. I have a Valentine bookmark that says, Smile, God loves you. And you can each have one of those to remember that God loves you. And then I also have one other thing that I found in the Christian bookstore. It's called the Kids Creed. And since we're focusing on family today, let me just share this with everybody out there so you can know what it says too. It says, don't make your parents mad. Always obey your mom and dad, okay? Always be kind to others, even your sisters and brothers, okay? Be careful when you play. Be safe each and every day. Don't pick up bad habits. They multiply like rabbits. Isn't that the truth? Let Jesus guide your thoughts. It was for this he fought. Find yourself a cozy little nook to read the Bible and other good books. Always choose your friends with care. And I'm going to talk about that a little bit in my sermon. In times of trouble, they will be there. Say your prayers to God every night and keep your world clean and bright. So I'll give you each one of these, too, that you can have. There you go. Colt and Jason Easton. There you go. All right. And then I have one more little gift. Okay. Since it's close to Valentine's Day, I have Hershey's Kisses here. So, all right. Yeah. And I have enough of these that I think I can give each of you 3 bags of these. Okay. So you can share some with other people. Okay. There you go. There you go. Okay. I also have some dark chocolate ones that I'll put downstairs in Fellowship Hall for fellowship time. Okay? All right. Thanks for coming up this morning, guys. Thank you. Okay. Now we're going to have the choir come up as we share our anthem with you this morning. Thank you. As Jay comes to share our scripture readings with us this morning, I would invite you once again to stand with me as we hear the word read, the reading of God's word read.
Morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Today's scripture reading, we'll start with the Old Testament reading, comes from the book of Joshua, chapter 24, verses 14 and 15. It starts, "Now fear the Lord and serve him with all faithfulness. Throw away the gods of your forefathers worshiped beyond the river and in Egypt, and serve the Lord. But if serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, then choose for yourself this day whom you will serve, whether the gods of your forefathers served beyond the river or the gods of the Amorite, in whose land which you are now living. But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord."
Amen.
And the New Testament reading comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 13. And Donna, I'm sorry, I can't jump in the middle of this. The chapter's called Love, the 13th chapter.
Yes.
So chapter 13 starts like, "If I speak in the tongues of men and of angels, but have not love, I'm only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have a faith that can move mountains, but have not love, I am nothing. If I give all that I possess to the poor and surrender my body to the flames, but have not love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It is not rude. It's not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects. It always trusts. It always hopes. And it always preserves." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Amen. You may be seated. And please join your hearts with me in prayer. Our loving God, love originates with you. You have shown us your love through your Son, Jesus. And we pray that in this time this morning, your Holy Spirit will be active and working in this place to show us that love anew, to show us what Jesus has done for us and what you call us to do in sharing your love with one another. May your Holy Spirit speak through me to the hearts of your people, that together we may be uplifted and encouraged, but we also may be challenged in our living for you. And we give you the praise and the glory in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Jay asked me before he read the scripture this morning if he could include those first verses, and I said, sure, I'm really only focusing on one phrase in the passage that's listed from verses 4 through 7. I might add that verse 8 says, love never fails, which is true, and we know that to be true. But we could make a full sermon out of just about any of these phrases in this passage, especially the one that says, love is patient. Could probably do a whole sermon series on that. But I want to start out by sharing a story about a high school senior who was asking his father's advice on how to impress his girlfriend when he took her out for Valentine's Day. His dad said, "Well, son, when you take her out to eat and you're sitting across the table from her, take her hand in yours, gaze lovingly into her eyes, and softly say, 'Wow. You have a face that would make time stand still.'" Well, when the boy took his girlfriend out to eat on Valentine's Day, he sat across the table from her, took her hand in his, and gazed into her eyes, but then he was nervous. His hands were shaking, and he couldn't quite remember exactly what his father had told him to say. And then suddenly he smiled and he said, "Whoa, babe, you've got a face that would stop a clock." Somehow I don't think that line worked too well for her. He was trying to follow his father's advice and express his love for her, but that's probably not what she heard in that statement. You remember when we were children? And I gotta get my little prop here. When we were children, many of us would take a flower like a daisy and pluck the petals off as we recited, "She loves me, she loves me not. She loves me, she loves me not. She loves me, she loves me not." And go all the way around the flower until we had just one petal left, hoping that that one would be, "She loves me." Okay? Now I got a mess. Okay? There we go. And some of the petals on that flower were "love me" petals, and the rest were "love me nots." Okay, and in these verses that Jay just read for us from 1 Corinthians 13, there are a lot of "love me nots." These are the things that we should not do in our relationships with others, whether it be a spouse or grandchildren or our children or grandchildren or even in our close friendships. And by the way, these words that the Apostle Paul gave us were intended to apply in all of our relationships. Now, I've used this passage often from 1 Corinthians 13 in many weddings, but it was never intended to apply just to the marriage relationship. It's for all our relationships. And I always encourage those who are getting married, when I use this passage, to take some time to share these verses and read them together on their 1 month anniversary, and then every month on that day for the first year, and then on every anniversary thereafter. And those words need to sink in to our minds, but even more so into our hearts. Now, why do you suppose the Apostle Paul included all these "love me nots" in his letter? Well, I believe it's because he knew that all of his readers and hearers were human, and therefore none of them were perfect, especially in their relationships with one another. In the Unshakable book, and I hope by now everybody's got a copy of this and are reading it, Nelson shares what he calls some comforting news, and that is every family is dysfunctional. Think about that for a minute. He says the question is, to what degree? I heard many years ago about a family whose members were constantly putting each other down, and someone commented that they put the "dis" in dysfunctional. Now, none of us want to live in a family like that, but let's be honest here. Have you ever said or done something that you wish you hadn't said or done? Especially with a family member? Have you ever unintentionally hurt a family member by something you said or did, or maybe even a friendship? The truth is that because we are human, none of us are perfect. So turn to your neighbor and say, "I'm not perfect." Now say, "You're not perfect either." No, just kidding, okay? You don't have to say that, okay? Although I think the boys up there may have been a little too quick to jump on that. But now, Nelson points out in his chapter on marriage issues in Unshakable that the sad cultural norm of the number of marriages that end in divorce, and it's about 50%, which is really disturbing. It's no wonder so many young people are choosing not to get married or are waiting longer before they take that step into marriage, but choosing to live together outside of marriage doesn't work either. That is not God's plan for our most intimate relationship. We all know that God instituted marriage when, at the end of Genesis chapter 2, God created Eve from one of Adam's ribs and brought them together in the Garden of Eden. And in verse 24 it says, "That is why a man leaves his father and mother and is united to his wife, and they become one flesh." Jesus also responds to a question about divorce by quoting this verse, and then he adds to it, "Let no one split apart what God has joined together." Nelson says, God's plan for marriage is that it will last forever, and that it will be the most fulfilling human relationship in your life. You may be wondering if either of those things is even possible, Nelson says, and he says they both are. Your marriage can survive, even thrive, but it takes some work. You can't coast through your marriage and expect it to remain strong. You have to open your eyes to your responsibility in keeping your relationship on course and healthy. So how do you do that? Well, I don't have time to go into great detail about all the principles that Nelson shares about how to keep your marriage on course and healthy, and so I encourage you to read or reread that chapter in the book and also the one later on family problems to get more direction in this area from his words. But I will tell you that I'm not an expert in this area, and if you ask Judy, she'll tell you I make a lot of mistakes. And Nelson would probably say the same about his relationship with his wife, but I encourage you to seek out those resources that will help you most in your marriage, in your family, and in your friendships. Now, one more thing before I go on to share some of these principles, and that is some of you may already have experienced an end to your marriage, either through divorce or through the loss of your spouse through death. And you may think, well, this doesn't really apply to me. It's not for me anymore, but that's not true. If you've been through a divorce especially, one of the phrases contained in 1 Corinthians 13 is, it, meaning love, keeps no record of wrongs. This is where forgiveness comes in, and it's so important in healing from a broken marriage or other relationship that might have been damaged, and I'm going to come back to that later. And for those of you who have had a spouse that has passed away, I encourage you to hold on to the good and precious memories that you have. You may have to forgive something too, even though that spouse is no longer here, but just let it go and begin to focus on your other family relationships and friendships in your life. I know that's not easy, but that's where you have to go after a period of time of loss. Now let me share some of the crucial principles of how to have an unshakable marriage, an unshakable family, and even extending to our friendships. In Unshakable, Nelson shares one of the most powerful principles in Scripture, and that is the principle of the first. The principle of the first holds that God will bless the areas of your life where you put Him first. Amen? First equals blessing, he writes. Putting God first in your family means actively trusting Him as the foundation for your family's life, as you relinquish your desire for control. And this goes back to that first principle that we shared a few weeks ago of unshakable faith, is that we need to secure a solid or firm foundation for our marriages and our family life. We heard the scripture reading from Joshua 24, verses 14 and 15 this morning, which Joshua concludes by saying, "But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord." This comes at the very end of the book of Joshua, when he is about to die at the end of his life, and as he's preparing to depart, God gives him this message for the people of Israel. He challenges them to throw away all the false gods that were worshipped by their ancestors and to serve the Lord and Him only. A simple definition of a false god or idol is something or someone that becomes more important to us than God. We may not worship idols or gods made of stone or wood today, but we have many false gods and idols in our culture and in our world. Self-centeredness is one of the greatest ones. We tend to worship self. Money, fame, status, physical appearance, entertainment, sex, food, technology, like these weapons of mass distraction, there's mine, that we carry around with us all the time. And the list can go on and on and on. We need to ask ourselves, is there anything in my life that is more important than God and my relationship with Jesus? We need to put God and Jesus first. And if God is at the center of our lives, our marriages, our family relationships, and even our friendships, then everything else will fall into its proper place. After we put God first, then we need to focus on our marriage and on our family. Then after marriage and family, we need to look at the other close friendships in our lives and see how we are applying these words of the Apostle Paul of loving one another. When I think about the things that Paul lists of what love does and does not do in this passage from 1 Corinthians, I'm reminded again that love is a verb. Love is a verb. It's true that actions speak louder than words. And it's not enough to just say, I love you. We need to put it into action. We need to demonstrate that love. And think about that as I share these principles of how you can put it into action in your marriage and in your family. First, in our marriage relationship, if you're married, Nelson offers a marriage survival kit, which is very helpful. He lists five things. First, schedule time for each other. I'm not always real good about that. Second, see the best in one another. Third, surrender the fight to be right. How many of us struggle with that? Okay. Fourth, shut the door on temptation. And fifth, set the spiritual direction for your marriage. And I want to emphasize that all of these are important. We can't just pick one or two. We need to focus on them all. For the sake of time, I don't have time to go into detail on all of these. So again, I strongly encourage you to take time to look at these as you read or reread the book, and then talk about them with your spouse, if you're married, with your family members. And most importantly, as I said, take action. Figure out what you need to do to put these into practice. And by the way, most of these can be applied just as effectively in your other family relationships and friendships as well as your marriage relationship. Just remember that after putting God first, focusing on your spouse and other family members should be the next priority. But I do want to take time to briefly address the last of these principles that Nelson shares, which is to set the spiritual direction for your marriage. You also need to set that spiritual direction for your family. We've all heard it said that the family that prays together stays together. And it's true. And we know the verse from Proverbs 22:6, which says, "Raise up a child in the way he or she should go." I like the way the New Living Translation puts it. It says, "Direct your children onto the right path, and when they are older, they will not leave it." There's another verse in Proverbs for those of you who are grandparents that says, "Grandchildren are the crowning glory of the aged." Now, I don't like that word aged, especially since I'm moving in that direction, but I know that that is true. How many of us love our grandchildren? I hope all do. Studies have shown that families who prioritize God, who spend time in prayer together, sharing Bible study and devotions together, and worshiping together, are healthier than families who don't do those things. When our children were young, we read them Bible stories, and mostly it was Judy that was doing that. We took them to Sunday school. We took them to worship services. We had discussions about our beliefs and our theology, and we still do. Those questions come up from our daughter occasionally. We have those discussions with our son occasionally. And we prayed over our children and prayed with them. And I'm blessed to say that both of our children are involved in churches today and have a strong relationship with Jesus as their Savior. We didn't always get it right. And just because you do these things does not guarantee that your children or grandchildren will stay in a relationship with God and the church. But chances are much greater that they will if you put God first in your family. Before I conclude this morning, I want to share that you don't get to choose your family members. They're a part of who you are in those relationships. And sometimes people in families do hurt each other, even unintentionally at times, but you do get to choose your friends. And it's important to instill in your children and your grandchildren that their friends need to be those who hold to the same values that you have in your family. I've seen too many young people choose the wrong path due to a bad influence of a so-called friend. And that's myself included in my high school years and even early college years. It's only by the grace of God and the influence of the godly people in my family and my friendships that I am where I am today. Praise God. One of those relationships that I had early on was with our Sunday school teacher in the little country church that we attended in my elementary school years. Aunt Mary was what we called her, and she is the one that taught me to read and love the Bible, the scriptures. Now, when there is hurt in your family relationships, Nelson shares one last principle that I want to leave with you this morning, and that is be quick to forgive your family members. This is not always easy, but it's crucial. And this goes back to that phrase in 1 Corinthians 13, which again says, love keeps no record of wrongs. Nelson says, refusing to forgive creates breakdown in the relationship, but forgiveness brings new life. The Apostle Paul wrote in Ephesians 4:32, be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. And the next part that Nelson shares in that passage is so powerful. When he writes, in light of the magnitude of what Jesus did on the cross, no grievance among family members is too big to be forgiven. Amen? Think about what Jesus did for you. Jesus took your sin and my sin upon himself so that we can be forgiven. Nelson goes on to say, while you and I were still wallowing in our sin, offending God in every possible way, he sent his son to die for us. Not after we straightened up or saw the light and apologized, but while we were still sinners, God sent Jesus into this world. And because God was able to reach out to us and offer us complete forgiveness, even as we were hurting him and our relationship with him, we have a responsibility to do the same for our loved ones. Now, I've often emphasized that when we hold a grudge against someone, when we refuse to forgive someone who has hurt us in some way, we are the ones who actually suffer from that, not the person who hurt us. We actually imprison ourselves, and we need to learn to forgive and let it go. No matter what we do to point our children in God's direction and to keep our relationships healthy with our spouse, our children, and our friendships, there will be times when things go wrong. Children will rebel and stray. I love this picture of teenage rebellion here. And notice she has her weapon of mass distraction in her hand. We may say or do things that hurt someone. And we can't always control these things. Sometimes they happen before we even think about it. But we can choose to trust God, to build a solid foundation, and to share his love with each other. So that when the storms come in our family relationships and our friendships, we can get through them together. We can forgive each other and move forward in God's grace and strength. Amen. And let's pray together. God, we thank you that you have given us our families, our marriages, our children, our grandchildren, those who are closest to us. And we admit that sometimes we mess up because we're human, we're not perfect. Sometimes we may say or do something that is hurtful. Help us to see where we need to get those things right. And help us to be able to forgive those who've done something that has hurt us in some way and to let it go and to let you take control of our family relationships, of our marriages, of our friendships, and guide us in your ways. Lord, we thank you that you sent Jesus into the world to give his life for our sins, that he has taken them away and that we are forgiven. Help us to extend that same love to the people around us and be willing to forgive and let go and move on and build anew. We give you the praise and the glory for all these things. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. At this time, I would invite our ushers to come as we present our gifts of our tithes and offerings this morning. Let's join together in our offertory prayer. Loving and sustaining God, you call us to obedience, to follow you in all things, to surrender our lives fully to you, and to give ourselves wholeheartedly to your purposes. We bring you our gifts of tithes and offerings, and ask you to bless them and use them to strengthen the ministries of your church. Expand our faith and our love for all people that we may reach out and share abundantly from the resources you have entrusted to us. We pray in the strong name of our Savior Jesus Christ and in the power of your Holy Spirit. Amen. You may be seated.
Please join with me in singing hymn 408, The Gift of Love.
As we come to our closing prayer this morning, I want to share a few prayer requests with you. First, we had a silent prayer request for a young man in his 40s who suffered a heart attack, and would ask your prayers for him and for his recovery and his healing. And then I know we have a couple people having knee surgeries coming up, so keep those people in prayer that are having surgeries. I want to continue prayers for Mike Haptonstall as he is getting radiation or preparing to begin radiation for cancer. And also Jane Allen. I don't know what her status is, but keep her in prayer as well. Some people have asked about our daughter who had COVID last weekend. She is up and going again. She's doing much better and was able to get out of her apartment a couple days this week. So praise God for that. And for all of those that have been through this recently, we're glad that they're on the mend and healing well. I do want to share some exciting news with you, and I don't know if you've seen this in any of the news stories that are out there, but we've been reading about it online. There is a revival that has broken out at Asbury University down in Wilmore, Kentucky. Praise God. It started on Wednesday morning at the end of the chapel service. There were students that didn't want to leave at the end of chapel that stayed in the chapel to pray. Those that went to class and felt like they really needed to be in the chapel praying, and so they asked professors permission to go back. And it's in its fifth day now that people have been gathering. They've been coming from neighboring churches. They've been coming from all over. And I heard that it's spread to a couple of other college campuses in Kentucky and that area as well. So praise God for what the Holy Spirit is doing in that area of our nation. And we pray that God's revival will come upon all of us and all of our churches. And with that in mind, let's turn to the Lord in prayer this morning. Our loving God, again, we are so thankful for the Holy Spirit's work in our lives, in our marriages, in our family relationships, in our friendships, and for what you are doing as your Spirit moves in the hearts of people that are confessing sin, that are getting relationships restored. Lord, we thank you for this revival that is happening down at Asbury University, that is spread throughout that area. We pray that the Holy Spirit will move in ways that will spread that throughout our land and into our hearts and into our relationships, Lord. We pray for healing, Lord, for those that are hurting from things that have been said or done that need to be forgiven and let go. Healing of bodies, Lord, as we lift up those who are going through surgeries or recovery from surgeries, and especially those that are going through cancer right now. We lift up Mike to you again and Jane and pray for your hand of healing to be upon both of them and others that are going through this struggle, Lord, and just restore them to wholeness and health again. Lord, may your Holy Spirit work in our hearts as we express love in our families, in our marriages, in our relationships, Lord. Help us to take to heart these words from the Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians 13 and know that you have called us to share the love of you, Lord God, with the people around us every day. Help us to put it into action in all that we say and all that we do. May it bring glory to your holy name. And we give you all the praise and all the glory in the mighty name of our Savior Jesus Christ as we pray together the prayer that he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Please rise as you are able, and let us join in the closing hymn, 560, Help Us Accept Each Other.
Be present.
Just a reminder that our youth have sub sandwiches downstairs, so please be sure to stop by there and pick up one or two this morning to take home with you for the Super Bowl later today. Remember the Community Black History Extravaganza next Sunday afternoon at 2 o'clock at the First Congregational Church if you want to take place in that. And then remember all the meetings that we have going on this week. If you're a part of any of those, please be with us for those meetings. And for Guild Circle on Wednesday night, that's resuming. And also the choir practice on Thursday night, that's resuming. And the Walk to Emmaus gathering next Saturday, the 18th. We invite anyone that would like to come and be with us for that as well. Now hear these words of blessing as we go forth. Oh God, we go out in your love to share that love with the people around us. May we be revived, may we be renewed, may we be strengthened and unshakable in our faith and our relationships as we go forward. We give you all the praise and all the glory in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Amen.